peoples.
Noura Erekat is an American-Palestinian human rights attorney and assistant professor at George Mason University. She joins us now. Noura, how do you think this decision will impact any sort of potential restart of peace talks?
You know, I think what this decision makes clear is that there are no peace talks, and the peace talks that have been taking place for over two decades have been farcical and have enabled Israel to continue its settler colonial expansion and land grab into the West Bank under the veneer of peacemaking. Since 1917, when Britain declared that there will be a Jewish national home in Palestine, the global north has declared that Palestinians do not exist. And for over 100 years, Palestinians have been demanding their freedom and insisting that we exist. What Trump has done today is to say that the global north will continue to help the evisceration of a Palestinian people and to force us into ghettoized sovereignty where we no longer make those claims. But that is untenable. No people has ever accepted that. And this just means that there is a new chapter of Palestinian freedom fighting and now to end apartheid completely.
And as you know, there have been decades of Democratic and Republican presidents who've tried to restart peace talks, move forward. It hasn't happened. I want to play a bite for you from President Trump from earlier about his decision.
Israel is a sovereign nation with the right, like every other sovereign nation, to determine its own capital. Acknowledging this is a fact is a necessary condition for achieving peace. Today, Jerusalem is the seat of the modern Israeli government. Today, we finally acknowledge the obvious, that Jerusalem is Israel's capital. This is nothing more or less than a recognition of reality.
What's wrong with the president saying that, you know, parts of Jerusalem will be the Israeli capital?
The part that's completely wrong with it is that Israel took over East Jerusalem through war in 1967, what the international community, including the Lyndon B. Johnson administration at the time, condemned and declared that there will be no acquisition of territory by force. Successive U.S. administrations have insisted that the final status of Jerusalem will be determined in peace negotiations, and rather than serve as the honest broker, the United States has helped Israel to incrementally take over Jerusalem to remove Palestinians. For five decades, since 1967, Israel has revoked 14,000 residency permits for Palestinian East Jerusalemites who can no longer live there because Israel is explicitly pursuing a Jewish demographic majority. In any other context, we would be condemning that. And yet today, we are crowning Israel's territorial acquisition by war by declaring this a unified capital.
But Noura, for folks who say, look, we've tried this, We just haven't come to a resolution. Why not do something bold, something different to
restart
this? Right.
Why not actually put pressure on Israel to abide by international law and human rights norms? You realize that Palestinians are being fragmented from one another, that they are actually living on reservations akin to Native American reservations in the United States or Bantustans in apartheid South Africa that have been internationally condemned. So rather than make a bold decision to actually put pressure on Israel and usher freedom for all peoples, we're going to instill a de jure apartheid regime and be proud of it. The United States was the most bold supporter of apartheid South Africa to fall, and Ronald Reagan was the last to finally rescind that support in the late 1980s. And this is going to be another condition where the U.S. is on the wrong side and will be the last domino to fall.
So do you think this is the end of a two-state solution at this point?
I think the two-state solution has been completely ended since 2001, and yet Palestinian leadership has clung onto it by sheer faith that U.S. as global superpower will deliver independence to it, notwithstanding empirical evidence devastating that possibility. Since in 1993, when the peace process started, there were 200,000 illegal settlers in the West Bank. Today, that number is 600,000. We have the United States to thank for that. We have ourselves to thank for that because of our tax dollars and our unequivocal military financial and political support to Israel. So what now it is made clear is that we can no longer make believe that there is a peace process. We have to admit that the United States is supporting Israel in a complete takeover of Palestinian lands where Palestinians will be given civil, religious, maybe some rights at the discretionary whim of Israel, but be denied their national rights, their freedom, their sovereignty and self-determination.
Noor, you say that the U.S. will be on the wrong side of history with this decision.
Absolutely.
So if not the U.S. to create a Palestinian state, then who?
That's up to the Palestinian leadership. There are a number of other countries that are willing to take the lead on this. The BRICS are a great option to move forward. In the 1970s, the Palestinian leadership was at the forefront of creating a third world alliance amongst the global south in order to resist colonial penetration. We have the option to move into a resistance era rather than to continue to pursue the tutelage of the United States in a counterproductive peace process. This is an opportunity for the Palestinian leadership. The Obama administration first gave us that opportunity in UN Security Council Resolution 2334. We refused to grab the mantle then. This is another opportunity now to pivot anywhere else besides the United States, because it is obviously not on the side of Palestinian freedom.
You know, there have been two rival Palestinian factions in the West Bank territories, Hamas and Fatah on one side with the PLO. Do you believe that this decision by President Trump might unite the two warring factions?
They actually have achieved a Palestinian reconciliation agreement recently that was brokered by Egypt and approved by the United States, Israel, and Saudi Arabia. They have been moving towards reconciliation, but it should be known that Israel has claimed that it has never had a partner for peace, notwithstanding all of the overtures that have been made to it. Saudi Arabia offered it peace in 2002 in the Arab Peace Initiative. Arafat offered them peace. Mahmoud Abbas has offered them peace and has been the most conciliatory Palestinian leader. And yet Israel has continued to propagate this myth of no peace partner when, in fact, it is pursuing its settler colonial ambitions and it not wanting peace, but instead to impose an apartheid reality where Palestinians can survive as supplicants under its discretionary whim.
Do you expect to see increased violence in the coming days?
I think that there's violence every day. I think that the fact that we're not paying attention to the structural violence that Israel imposes on Palestinians is the reason that Americans can be so compliant and listen to President Trump make these statements about Jerusalem. There is violence every day that Palestinians endure, and that's what we should be paying attention to. That this is going to lead into more clashes and more violence that obscures these reality is very likely. But if that's what our priority is, it's precisely why we're moving in the wrong direction.
Noora Arakat, thank you so much for joining us, Noora.
Thank you for having me.